Good morning, friends. Today I'll be studying the X-ray diffractions. As we are aware that we are out of town, so it's not possible to take the lectures. So we'll take by this PPT method. So this content of this chapter is mainly the introduction, principle, instrumentations, X-ray diffraction methods, applications and limitations. So we'll start with the first with the introductions. So what is the X-rays? These are X-rays are mainly produced, these are short wavelengths we can say. These are mainly produced, or we can say first noticed by the William Rontgen, who mainly given the X-rays are very short length. The size is ranges from the 0.01 nanometer to about the 10 nanometers. And the contribution to the X-rays is by the William Rontgen and the Max Wenyu. They gave the two types of X-rays, mainly the hard X-ray and the soft X-rays. Hard X-rays are which are having the high frequency or more energy, or the penetration power is more. The soft X-rays are which having the less penetration and low frequency. So in a simple words, we can say X-rays are the short wavelength electromagnetic radiations which are produced by the deceleration. Deceleration is nothing but whenever the high intensity electrons are interacting with the any metal targets, it produces different electrons. And when electrons are produced which interact with the metal target, then it produces the X-rays. A transition of the electrons takes place from the inner orbital, from outer orbital to the inner orbital, and to the ejaculation of the positive photons, or we can say positive X-rays. So timeline, how this X-ray get mainly evolved, starting from the 1665, Maria Grigliometti was the Italian mathematician who mainly gave the diffraction effects. Later on, 1868, X-ray was discovered by the German scientist called Rontgen. For this work of discovery of the X-ray, he got the first Nobel Prize in 1901. Later on, the X-ray diffraction crystals was discovered by only in 1912, and finally the Bragg's theory came into existence. So why only the X-rays we are studying though? The X-rays are very short wavelength, nearly about the wavelength is nearly 1 angstrom. We can see in the figure, this is the X-ray. Range is 10 raised to 10 angstrom. So we can say the wavelength of X-ray photons is not the distance between the nuclei of is about the 1.5 angstrom to 2.5 angstroms. So you can say whatever the different crystals are there, the crystals are having the small unit cell. When this high intensity, or we can say X-rays are produced, passed through this unit cell or the crystals, we can surely determine the distance between the two crystals with the help of X-rays, as these are having the short wavelength, but the penetration power is more. So we can say X-rays are nothing but these X-rays are used to study the crystal structure of the different atoms or the molecules, or the distance between the two nuclei, or the distance between the two atoms, or the distance between the two crystals can be done with the help of these X-rays. So how this production of the X-rays takes place? This production of the X-rays can be done by with the help of the X-ray tubes. You can see this is a glass tube which is made of the X-ray tubes. It mainly consists of the two parts. First is your anode, which is made of the copper. Next is your cathode, which is also the emitter, we can say. It is made of the tungsten. And these two, cathode and anode, which are connected to the high voltage, when the potential difference is applied between the cathode and anode, or we can say when this cathode is heated to the high temperature with the help of the high potential, that time it emits a continuous source of electrons. Whatever the electrons are that, electrons interact with this anode. When interact with this anode, then what happens? This anode mainly acts as a metal target. So these electrons interact with this metal target. Electrons transfer that kinetic energy towards this anode. And this whatever the kinetic energy which is absorbed, and remaining part of the kinetic energy can be emitted in the form of X-rays. So in this way, the production of the X-ray takes place. In simple words, we can say there is a cathode. Cathode is heated to the high temperature. When it is heated to the high temperature, it interacts with the anode. When it interacts anode, it transfers the kinetic energy towards the anode. When it transfers the kinetic energy towards the anode, the production of the X-ray takes place. Three types of the X-ray absorption methods. First is your X-ray absorption method. Sorry, three types of X-ray spectroscopic method technique. X-ray absorption method, X-ray diffraction method, and third is your X-ray fluorescence method. In X-ray absorption method, absorption of X-ray takes place. In X-ray diffraction, diffraction of the X-ray takes place. In X-ray fluorescence method, whenever the electrons interact with the metal targets, it emits the electrons from the ground state to the excited state. When it comes to the excited state to the ground state, it emits the fluorescence. So we can say, whatever the metal target is there, that metal target is having the power or which is having the property to emit the fluorescence. How this X-ray diffraction takes place? You can see in the diagrams here, this is the X-ray particles which interact with X-ray beams, which interact with the crystals. When it interact with the crystals, we know that crystals are made of the different atoms, and the atoms consist of the different electrons. When it interact with this, whatever the X-ray which interact with these X-ray crystals, it diffract the beam. So what you can say, whatever the X-rays are there, the X-rays are diffracted with a slight bending of light around the edge of an object. So whatever the diffracted beams are there, diffracted beams get interact with the photographic plates, and with photographic plates is there, it forms the thin spots. So interaction of these X-ray and atoms, this can be given by the Bohr's atomic model. We can say atoms are different whatever the metal target is there, or we can say whatever when we want to study the different crystal structures of any molecules, you know that molecule is consisted of the small atoms, and this atom consists of the different electrons and neutrons. In the center we can say this is the neutrons. Whenever the X-ray interact with these atoms, there is no change, or the X-ray scattering cannot be takes place by the nuclei, but whatever the surrounding electrons are, we can say that these are the shells. Innermost shell, we can say it is a K shell, is the L shell, and this is M shell. K shell, it consists of the two electrons, innermost shell. Periphery to the outer shell is there the 8 electrons. Whenever this X-ray are incident on these atoms, what happened? The innermost electron gets skip out in the form of X-ray. Whatever the electron which has been skipped out, that's vacant electrons position is taken by the outermost orbital. In this way the X-ray can be produced. We can see in the simple words, whenever the incident X-ray interact with any atoms, the innermost electrons get skip out, and vacant electrons position can be taken by the outermost shell electrons, and in this way the X-ray are produced. So X-ray diffraction is nothing but it is a constructive interference. We can see in the diagram, we can see there is an incident beam which interacts with the sample crystals. When it interacts with the sample crystal, the small bending of the angle takes place at an angle 2 theta. Whatever the diffracted beam are there, that is a constructive interference. Means whatever the interference which are there, that is a constructive interference, but not a destructive interference. Whatever the waves are there, that the waves are reinforced to each other. And whatever the diffracted beams are there, that can be recorded by the different detectors. So this diffraction can be given by the Bragg's law. Bragg's law is nothing but these are the father and son. We have the Bragg's sons and father, mainly given the Bragg's equations. We can see in the diagram, there is a X-ray crystals. We know that whatever that some molecules are there, molecules are considered the small crystals, and the crystals are aligned to each other with a small spacing with the layer. There are the two lattice. First lattice, the second lattice. Or the second, first plane or the second plane. Whenever the incident beam interact with the first plane, it is diffracted with a small angle theta. Then there is a second beam which interacts with the second plane, it is also diffracted with a small angle theta. So whatever the distance between the two diffracted beams is there, if that distance is called as a d, and whatever the angle which is formed, we can see here the distance covered by the first beam is ab, but this distance covered by the second beam is ab plus bc. But we know that ab is equal to bc, so we can say n lambda is equal to twice ab. The final equation which we obtain through this principle, or through this Bragg's formula, is n lambda is equal to 2 sin theta or we can simple words, we can say lambda is equal to 2 sine theta d divided by n, where d is the spacing between the two angle, theta is the incident angle, and n is the integer, and lambda is the wavelength of the beam. X-ray diffraction methods. How this X-ray can be diffracted? There are three techniques by which the X-ray diffraction can be done. Already we have studied how this X-ray are produced. X-ray are produced by the X-ray tubes. There is a cathode, there is an anode. Whenever the cathode is heated, it produces the electrons. It interacts with the anode, and that time the interaction, the different X-ray can be produced. There are three main techniques by which the X-ray can be produced. There are Lewy method, rotating crystals method, and third is your powder method. So Lewy method. Lewy was the first scientist who mainly invented the given the X-rays. When this technique can see that there is the X-ray tubes, through that the X-ray are produced. When it interacts with the crystals, we know that the slight bending of the crystals it produces the X-rays. And this X-rays interact with the photographic film. We can see in the diagram there is a photographic film. Whenever this X-ray is there, they interact with the photographic film, and when this instead of the photographic plane, we can get the different X-ray crystals. Two types of the techniques, transmission Lewy method and back reflection method. In the transmission method, see here, there are the two techniques, transmission Lewy and second is the back reflection. There is a small change. Whatever the X-ray crystals are there, when the photographic plane film is behind the crystals, it is called as the it is in the case of transmission Lewy method. X-ray are there, X-ray interact with the crystals, it produces the diffraction beam, it interacts with the photographic plate, and we get the photographic X-ray. Or we can say X-ray diffraction can be done. In case of back reflection, whatever the crystals are there, photographic film is placed front of this X-ray crystals, and the X-ray are produced, which can be again reflected by back in case of in the plane of hyperbola. Second is rotating crystals method. In the rotating crystals method, there is the incident beam, which is as incident beam. Whatever the crystals are, that photographic film is covered with the crystals in the form of cylindrical pattern. When the incident beam, incident on this photographic film, it produces interact with this photographic film, and we get the when this photographic plane is plane put in the horizontal pattern, we can get the spots of this X-ray, diffracted spots. Powder crystals method. In powder crystals method, whatever the X-rays are there, the X-rays are passed through this powder, and you can get, you know that powder is considered a small cell called as a unit cells. When this X-ray are passed through this unit cells, we can get the small spots of the X-ray. Instrumentations, whatever this X-ray diffraction method is there, XRD is there, it mainly consists of the production of X-rays, collimator, monochromator, detector. We can see in the diagram, X-ray are produced in the X-ray tubes as we already studied. This X-ray are passed through the collimator. Then it interacts with the sample. After interacting with the sample, the diffraction takes place and it goes to the detector. So, what are the role of these X-ray tubes? First is the production of X-ray. As we already studied, how this production of X-ray takes place. Next is collimator. Collimator is nothing but, we know that whatever the beam is there, it is mainly not a narrow, it is a broad. In order to get a narrow, it has to pass through the small collimator. Collimator observes all the X-rays except the narrow beam that pass through the gaps. We can say whatever the X-rays are there, broad X-rays are absorbed and the others are passed through the gap. Monochromator is nothing but to isolate the narrow frequency, whatever the desired frequency of the X-rays which are needed, that can be isolated. So monochromator is an optical device that mainly transmit the selectable narrow band of wavelength chosen from the wide range of wavelength available at the inputs. So this monochromator are used to isolate the particular wavelength. Whatever the desired wavelength is there, it can be passed through the monochromator. So this monochromator can be broadly classified into types: interference filters and the crystal monochromator. So crystal monochromator can be further classified into two types: flat crystal monochromator and curved crystal monochromator. So we'll see the first one, that is the interference filter. So what are the interference filter? If you see this interference filter, so these interference filters are nothing but these are small filters which can be inserted. And this filter mainly allows the desired wavelength to pass. But whatever the undesirable wavelengths or the radiations are there, that are isolated. So this interference filter, mainly used to made of the quartz or the transparent metals, which allows the suitable wavelength to pass. Whatever the undesired wavelength that is there, that can be isolated. Next is your crystal monochromator. Crystal monochromators are nothing but these are the made of the suitable crystalline matter, material like NaCl, lithium, fluoride and quartz. And these crystal monochromators mainly works by the reflecting at the specific angle which is suitable for the Bragg's equations. Whatever the reflection which takes place, which is at the angle to theta, which is suitable for the Bragg's equations and which is made of the lithium, fluoride, NaCl and quartz. So we can say narrow beam of X-ray are used pass, and whatever the broad wavelength is there, that is isolated by the monochromator. So we can say in the simple words, whatever the monochromators are there, these monochromators are used to pass the narrow beam of wavelength and isolate the broad beam of wavelength. Two types of monochromators: interference monochromator and crystal monochromator. Next, detectors. Detectors are nothing but whatever the diffracted beams are there. Diffracted beams are mainly pass from the diffraction of the samples. Whatever the diffracted beams are there, the diffracted beams of a sample diffraction beams are there. Whatever the incident X-rays interact with the samples, whatever the diffraction beams are there, the diffraction beam can be detected by the detector, which is rotating with the specific angles. So these detectors can be major classified into two categories: imaging detectors like photographic plates and X-ray film detectors. We can say first is your imaging detectors, photographic plates and X-ray film detectors. Next is your visual digital devices like cell counters methods, like Geiger mill scintillator detectors. These are the different detectors which are digitizing devices. So types of detectors: photographic methods, and second is your counter methods. In photographic methods, photographic plates are used. In counter methods, mainly the different gases are there. Their gases are mainly interacting with the X-ray beams. When it interact with the X-ray beams, whatever the expansion of this gas takes place. So both the types of method depends upon the ability of X-rays to ionize the matters and differ only in the substrate fate of electrons produced by the ionizing process. First is your photographic methods. In photographic methods, whatever the incident, you can see in the diagram, this is the incident X-ray which interact with the samples. When it interact with the samples, whatever the different diffracting beams are produced, this diffracting beams goes to the photographic plates. When it goes to the photographic plates, whatever the different spots of the X-rays can be formed, and these X-ray different spots of the X-rays can be detected by your photographic methods. Next is Giger Miller counter methods, which is a method. It is under the counter methods. Under the counter method, first is your Giger Miller tube methods. We can see here. This is a in the diagram. We can see here. This Giger Miller tube is there, which is filled with the argon gas. To that tube, there is a small window which is made of the mica. Through this mica window, mainly the X-ray are passed. It also consists of the anode and cathode, which is maintained at the potential of 800 to 1500 volts. So when the X-ray has passed through this mica window, it interact with the argon gas, the expansion of the gas takes place, or with the ionization of the gas takes place. When the ionization takes place, whatever the electrons ionization of this argon atoms takes place, resulting in the production of electrons, and this electrons mainly go to the central anode. Next is your proportional counter, same to the Geiger-Müller tube counter. It also consists of the gas field. If there is a field of the gas, mainly there is anion and krypton here. It is interact with this gaseous, expansion of this gas takes place, or the ionization of this gas takes place, emission of the electrons takes place. Whatever the emission of the electrons are there, that the electrons goes to the electrodes. Scintillator detector. This is the advanced form of the Geiger-Müller tube, and in this we can see the hot and high energy of the photons are mainly gets. In scintillator detector, the sodium iodide crystals are mainly used with small amount of thallium. When X-ray is incident of these crystals, so what you can say, the ionization of the gas takes place. Ionization takes place. When ionization takes place, it emits the electrons. When the emission of the electrons are there, it goes to focusing electrons. Through the focusing electron, it goes to the photomultiplier tubes. And in this way, whatever ionized electrons are there, that can be detected. So in case of the scintillator detector, sodium iodide, anthracene, naphthalene, and paraterphenyl is mainly used as a crystals. Semiconductor is also the one of the type of the Geiger-Müller counter, which works on the same principles. Whatever the electrons are produced, that goes to the electrode, and the amount of the diffracted beam can be calculated. So, whatever the you can see in the chapter we studied in the X-rays, when it interacts with the X-rays or interact with any samples, the diffraction takes place. Whatever the diffracted beams are there, in the diffracted beams are there, interact with the samples and it produces the photographic plates. So there are the, in the application we can say, this photographic X-ray techniques are there. The X-ray techniques can be used to detect the small crystals, to find the unit cells. Whatever the distance between the crystals can be also determined, particle size can also be determined. It is for the weathering and the degradation of natural and synthetic materials. So, in the overview of this X-ray techniques, we can say these X-ray techniques are mainly used to study the X-ray crystal structure, particle size, or it has many wide applications. So, we will take the overview of these X-ray techniques. So what happens, how these X-rays are produced, or how these X-rays are developed? X-rays are nothing but short wavelength which are given by the scientists quite at the wrong time. When, how these X-rays are produced? So we can say there is X-ray tubes. It consists of the cathode and anode. These cathodes are heated to the high temperature. It produces the electrons. With these electrons interact with this the anode. When it interact with the anodes, whatever the electrons are there that interact with this sample metal targets atoms. Atoms consist of also electrons. Electrons are ejected. Electrons from the outer innermost orbital goes outside. So its position is taken place by the outermost orbital. And in this way, the X-ray photons are emitted and X-rays are produced. There are the three types of X-rays: X-ray absorption, X-ray diffraction, and X-ray fluorescence. So whatever this X-ray which are produced, it has the different sources. Then Bragg's equation. This Bragg's equation, we know that it is given by the Bragg's son and father. It gives a suitable equation. N lambda is equal to 2d sin theta, or we can say lambda is equal to 2 sin theta d divided by theta. So X-ray diffractions can be used to characterize different materials like phase analysis, lattice parameter determination, strain determination, texture and orientation analysis, order disorder, transform, and many more things. Thank you.